This program is brought to you by UCKG.
Good afternoon and welcome to A Different Kind of Woman. We are a different kind of woman because we believe that we can always aspire to make a change. On today's show, Bad Girls to Good Women, we're going to be talking about our past. How much of our past actually influences who we become today? We're going to be discussing this, but first of all, let's see what else is coming up on today's show. Next, we're going to be discussing the dark past of some of our team. At 4:15, find out what the people of the streets of London think with Jennifer Lon. At 4:25, we'll find out about rehabilitation through music with Amy's Yard. And later, we'll be talking to Carlotta Allam about her own transformation and charity stretch. Bad Girls to Good Women, that's what this show is about. And I'm your host, Shireen, but I'm not alone in the studio because I'm actually surrounded by a lot of bad girls right here. Mm-hmm. And first of all, I'd like to introduce you our dynamic Diana.
Hi.
Hi, Diana, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
Actually, you are one of the stories we're going to be talking about today, right?
Yes.
But you look so innocent.
I am.
She does.
Oh, okay, yeah, all right. So we'll be talking about that shortly. And our other fellow bad girl is our spectacular Sam.
Hi.
Sam, what could you possibly have to tell us about
Absolutely
your past?
Absolutely nothing.
Right, okay, then that's the end of the show then. Thank you guys for tuning in. And co-hosting with me today is our lovely but lavish, I had to give her two because, you know, she's our co-host, Lisa. How are you, Lisa?
It's good to be in this role, isn't it?
It happens.
It doesn't.
It's going to be a great show. Wonderful show.
I agree.
So, ladies, tell us, who wants to start? I mean, you're looking wonderful today, glamorous, smiles on the faces, but things weren't always like that, were they? Who wants to go and tell
well,
us
I mean,
a bit
what
about
do you want to know, Shree?
Well, apparently I've heard that your name was not actually called Sam, it was called something else.
Yes, yeah. In those days they used to call me Shaka.
Oh, what? Why
so
is that
was
then?
The nickname. I think I was very shocking, very bold, very daring. Mm. And the name stuck with me, I suppose.
Who gave you that name?
Some friends.
what were
negative influences.
Okay. Yeah. Why did they give you that name, though? And what kind of wealth?
Do you know what it was? At the time, you know, lots was going on. And they actually linked it with, like, the Zulu warrior, Shaka.
Okay.
But then somehow it got changed. And then I was very shocking in those days because I would colour my hair and... You know, very bold, very flamboyant, very courageous. Not that I'm, not
I
that
can
I'm,
see that.
Not that I'm not now,
yeah.
But in a slightly different way.
Okay, about this difference, Sam, I mean, what kind of lifestyle are we talking about? We know that today you're very successful, you're a manager, you're a mother, you're here on the show, you're always talking about your story and confidence. But what kind of lifestyle did you come from back then?
Well, when you say come from, I tell you something, Shireen. I actually came from a very well-privileged upbringing.
Mm.
My parents were, they came from Jamaica in the very early days, and I was actually born here. And they gave us a very, we grew up, my sisters and I, we grew up with a very privileged upbringing, very good schools, very middle-class upbringing, well provided for. Never ever saw my parents do anything criminating at all. And that was my upbringing.
Okay.
Although I did experience negative things as a young, which I've spoken about on the shows before. However, never linked with my parents and my upbringing or schooling or anything like
that. So what kind of changed how you, from what you grew up to then to Shaka? What happened?
The change started, I believe, with just going out with one guy. My first love, in fact, it was. And he was very connected with criminal activities. He was very... And where I thought at the time that I would be able... I felt sorry for him at the time, and I thought that I was going to be able to influence him, because I was... My lifestyle was very different. In fact, I'd been doing... I was at a young age where I was doing a lot of modelling. My career was at its peak. You know, you're at that time in your life where everything's going for you.
Yeah.
And I'm doing very well. I'm seeing myself in lots of magazines and things like that, getting quite popular as a young lady. But that sudden turn, that taking that wrong decision. And I went out with a guy who would not have been my parents' first choice. And for me at the time, it was like, gosh, excitement. It was like going down the fast lane. It was a total opposite.
You were curious, weren't you?
I was curious. I was curious. And I started to date him. He became my partner. And his lifestyle was totally opposite from mine. Mm. He was involved with all types of things, drugs, criminal activities, things that, you know what you're not going to wish your young daughter to be involved with. So you can imagine, for my parents, it was like a shock for them. You know, for me, them investing in this young girl, and suddenly she's picking somebody from the darker side of life to start her life with.
So you were like this kind of modern day Bonnie and Clyde then, because I'm taking that you assisted him.
In actual fact, we used to be called that.
Right.
They used to call us Bonnie and Clyde because it was like we were very inseparable, and everywhere he was, I was. You know, and at the time, I was in love with him at the time, but I thought that I would be able to change his life, take him from that lifestyle and show him a different lifestyle. But in actual fact, it influenced me. Before I know it, I was giving up my career, the things, my dreams, my goals that I wanted to do. And I was actually getting more and more involved in his lifestyle.
So how involved did you get? What was at the peak? Who was Shocker?
Well, Shocker was... I was a female who friends was only male. So it was very gangster type of friends. Mm-hmm. Most of my friends were involved with criminal activities, drugs, money, criminal activities. And very, very serious people. In fact, these were my friends. Mm. So I loved them. I had a relationship with these friends. You know, as well as my partner. They became good friends of mine. Mm. Some of them were almost like bodyguards to me. Mm. You know, we used to have big promotion, celebrities coming over to sing, and artists and things like that. And that was the lifestyle, you know, going into clubs with the men and not paying and things like that. It was... But it was all to do with drugs and money.
Wow.
Drugs and money, criminal activities, different types of robberies, those kind of things. And I got involved.
Okay, so she doesn't look anything like
She definitely doesn't. And before we go into Diana's story, because obviously I know, Diane, your story is also quite similar, we're going to take a short break, actually, and have a look at what Jennifer Lon found out from the people of the streets of London about this topic.
How responsible do you think a person's past is for the present?
A person's past really defines their present, because all the experiences, you build on your experiences. So obviously, I think your past shapes your present to a large extent, but you can break away from it too.
You can either let your past affect you, or you can move on from it.
If someone's done something bad in the past, yes, it could affect their future decisions, but if they're willing to take aboard what they've done and change it, then yeah, that will affect what happens in the future.
What you've done in the past will teach you You definitely learn from your mistakes.
Very responsible, because the past impacts how they deal with life in the present. So it just depends on what it is that's happened. But I do believe that things that happen to people during childhood will affect them in their adult life, yes.
How easy do you think it is to start again after prison?
Everybody has the chance to grow again. Everybody has the ability to make a new start, I think.
I think it's very difficult to start again after prison. I mean, you're institutionalised, for one. Gone into prison. How many chances have you given in prison in terms of education, in terms of, you know, confidence and also support when you come out?
There's not much help to rehabilitate people either. And I think it can be very tough if you don't give them proper help.
I wouldn't say it's as easy as it could be, because we've got preconceived ideas of people who've been in prison.
I think the problem is the prison system, not necessarily prisoners, that you're not reforming, you're not helping them be in society. They haven't been in society in so long, and suddenly you're just telling them you're free. Well, you can't just do that. You have to shape them within prison, and like maybe psychological help in prison would help them much more, like integrate in society, and yeah.
This programme is brought to you by UCKG. This program is brought to you by UCKG.
Welcome back to DKW, and on today's show we're talking about bad girls to good women. And before the break we were hearing the very shocking story of one of our DKW teens, Sam, from a gangster lifestyle to what we're going to be discussing later. But we've also got Diana's story. So Diane.
Hi.
Tell us, where did you come from? Anything similar?
I'm listening to Sam, actually. We know each other, but, you know, our stories are really similar. My free reign, so to speak, started when I was about 13. My parents were together until that age. And once my dad left home, just like Sam, you know, it's Jamaican background, very, you know, well presented, you know, very disciplined. And it was like when he left, it was like, wow, for me, you know, and I went off the rails, literally went off the rails. I found my first love, just like Sam, you know, was into that kind of lifestyle as well. You know, it didn't seem heavy at the time. Because to you, you're in that environment, so it's not a heavy environment, you know. It's normal to you. It's normal to you to get up and, you know, smoke and drink and, you know, do a little criminal activity here and there and make some money.
So from 13?
That was, yeah, yeah.
Wow, basically. You beat my days.
At 13, I started to smoke weed and I started to drink. And I did that in the environment of my own home. I didn't go outside and I wasn't, like, hiding away from what I was doing, you know. I'm kind of bold in what I do, and I was that anything I did, I wasn't hiding it, basically.
So what was your family saying? I know your father wasn't there, but about your mum?
So my mum's husband, he used to smoke weed, and that's who I got my first spliff off. It was my mum.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Me and him and my sister was in the room one day, and I used to smoke anyway, cigarettes, and, you know, that was the day that, you know, that was my test. You know, they sat down, gave me my spliff, I smoked it. Mm. I was laughing all night, you know. Oh, like,
So did your mum know?
My mum didn't know that night, okay. But eventually she found out. But for me, it was the thing like, well, do you want me to go and do it outside where you can't see me? Or do you want me to do it so you know what I'm doing? You know,
and they accepted the letter.
That was always my motto, you know. When I first started to have sexual intercourse, I went to my mum and I said, look, take me to the clinic so I can get the pill. And she was like, she wanted to kill me, you know. And I was like, well, what do you want me to do, mum? Do you want me to come in and say I'm pregnant, or do you want to sort me out? And that was me all the time. I was very bold in
so you kind of led your parents' decisions.
It wasn't a choice. It wasn't that I led them.
You didn't give them choice.
That's right. It wasn't a choice. I was doing it, you know. I used to go to school. I used to, if I wasn't going to school, I'd be at home in bed. I wasn't bunking, you know. I'm not going to school. That's the bottom line. I'm just not going, you know. If I went to school and left school to go and make money, I was going to make money. And then I'd come back to school, you know. I can remember one time where, you know, the teacher phoned my mum and said, you know, your daughter's just come into school and asked us to change a £50 note. Where did she get that from? Because I took a cab back to school after making money. Do you get what I mean? And I'm like, I'd go home and mum say, what are you doing? I'd be like, it's not their business.
So from a teenager, you were already doing this kind of thing?
I was doing it from a teenager.
But did it get worse?
Yeah, I suppose it did get worse.
What was your worst thing?
For me, I had done I was in with a crew, and I was doing fraud. And I kind of came in on the tail end of that fraud, and they was making some serious money, but they was being surveillance way before I came in on the tail end. And at the end of it, they all got arrested. And I left London, and I went somewhere. And I didn't get arrested, but one of the guys sent me the statements, and I should have been arrested. From what I was reading, you know, they knew everything about us, everything. And, you know, the scale of the fraud was millions. It went into millions. And I was like, you know what, I'm going down for a very long time. And that kind of shook me, I suppose. I used to always do criminal activities, but I used to always work as well. So I had my hands in both sort of, you know, I used to always think the police ain't going to be able to take anything away from me because I'm legit on one side, but I'm doing my little thing on the other, you know? And that's how I used to look at it. So that was kind of like the wake-up call for me, you know, this is time to stop this kind of lifestyle. I didn't want that kind of lifestyle no more. I didn't want the drug dealer. I didn't want the guns in my face. I didn't want all of that anymore. It was a decision that I actually kind of...
We're going to talk more about how you both changed later on in the show, but I want to ask you a question. You know, this is a lot of... Well, for both of you, you started kind of changing your ways from a very young age. How much of it... I mean, Sam, you were saying that your family really did bring you up quite well. But how much would you say was down to your actual parenting or your community side?
In my case, mine wasn't my parenting at all, and it wasn't even my environment at all. It wasn't even my schooling, because actually when I was actually an adult when my partner was my first love, so I hadn't been into even a sexual relationship. So he was actually the first person I had a sexual relationship with. So he was actually my first love.
So why did you... Because I find your story quite interesting, the fact that it's like you've had everything given to you. So you've kind of got like the ideal life that everybody wants.
Yes.
A good family, good education. Your community is a really good one. You've got extracurricular activities that you're doing. You're doing really well in them. So you're just success. So what made you attract this other side? What made you say no?
I think it was... I think it's curiosity, I think, more than anything. But I think, I mean, when I look at things now, and I dig deep into my roots of my behaviour, I think there was the rebellious behaviour. I think it manifested itself at that stage in my life, because when I look back on my life at a childhood, I've spoke about before about my at the age of seven, my next door neighbour exposing his sexual parts to me. And I didn't speak about that until an adult. So I think at some point, you know, when you have traumas, but they're hidden and they're buried. I think in my case, that trauma from a child was buried. So although I had a good upbringing, the trauma was that...
So it was an internal thing.
It was an internal behaviour.
In this kind of curiosity.
And I think it manifested that it rebelled in that way. I think sometimes we see children behave in particular... they rebel in a certain way. But 9 times out of 10, it's some form of... something that's triggered it.
Was it as well that... Was that world shielded from you at all? I mean, were you ever...
I was never exposed to that type of, because I was never exposed to that type of upbringing. I mean, my sister, I have an older sister who had lots of criminal friends, and you know, her baby father was very much involved in that type of thing. So I think that was the link.
Because I think for some people, if they're not aware of it, and like you said, you got to, you know, you're an adult almost, then it's kind of like bright lights, you know.
And the actual fact, the attention that I got, because remember at that time they hadn't actually met someone like, well, my partner at the time, he hadn't ever met anybody like me, and I'd never met anybody like
him. So you got that attention.
So and the attention that you got, and you know, those type of guys, they tend to want to flourish you with goods and...
Sounds like a ghetto version of My Fair Lady.
In actual fact, it is. And they want to shower you with goods and things, and they want to show you off and things. And it was that kind of thing. So at that stage of my life, you know, 19, 20, those age, you're like, wow. You know, this lifestyle.
I find that really interesting, because it's almost like, Diana, your dad, you kind of did the same thing. It was kind of money-oriented, isn't it? Kind of money-driven. Like, not going to school, I just want to go make some money, I want to make some money, I want to have this. But even with all your collections, you weren't happy.
No, I can't say that, you know, inside I was fulfilled, I had that. It was an exciting time, and I liked the excitement. I used to like to go out and rave at a weekend, like yes. Sam was saying, to walk into a rave. I never paid for anything.
That's right.
Do you understand? I used to drink champagne, smoke weed, whatever. And that was the lifestyle. That was just how it was.
You know, just spinning off from your story, Diane, is we can think about Amy Winehouse. And actually, many people still mourn her death, even though she's passed for some time now. And, you know, Amy, she was very passionate about what she was doing. She was a youngster that was very talented. And, of course, when she passed away in 2011, you know, not only did she leave a big hole in the hearts of her family members and her friends, it was such a shock to so many people around the world. You know, I think every time we think about her, we just think about, oh, my goodness, what a waste of such, you know, potential. And actually, in the same year, her family were inspired to make the Amy Winehouse Foundation.
Yes.
In September of that year. Actually, that I think it was on the 14th of September, it would have been her birthday. And that foundation is so special because it works to help young people, prevent them getting into drugs and this kind of lifestyle, alcohol. And we decided to pop along to see what Amy's foundation, Amy's Yard, does. And take a look at this video before we go to a short break.
Amy Winehouse's family created her legacy here at Amy's Yard, which supports young disadvantaged people through music. I'm here to find out how it's transformed some of their lives. Let's go and find out more. I'm here with Janice, Amy's mum. How do you hope that Amy's Yard will transform the future of young people?
It's about giving them opportunities for them to do it themselves because they have got it. And that's what it is. We're giving them confidence in themselves.
So Amy's Yard now, what we've narrowed it down to is a 12-week programme. It's an artist development programme, which is now AQA accredited. So throughout the 12 weeks, I'll have a weekly studio session in Amy's studio with our producer, Urban. They'll make an original track during that time and understand all of the aspects of making a track. And they'll attend two weekly masterclasses with people like Island Records, Metropolis Music, Handel Recruitment.
And how do you decide who to have and who not to have? Is it like that?
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, I think because the programme's been growing slowly, we've been quite cautious in not over advertising it. So we've kind of invited smaller groups of organisations to refer young people. So basically, they're all working with young people that are very vulnerable. So primarily, we want to give these opportunities to young people that wouldn't normally have access to them. So on a daily basis, these young people are facing a lot of different difficulties in their lives. So they could be homeless, they could have addiction issues, they could have a number of these issues. They've usually got quite a lot going on, but they're also stand out as being very talented, and so they're already making music. So this isn't like a just come and try out music. These organisations have seen their progress and their development and their commitment, and they send them to us to say, okay, I think they're ready for this next step. She was messing with my head.
It's just about finding your way. In this industry, it's hard. It's hard to know how to get in. There's not a job application in the newspaper that says, you know, do you want to be an artist? Tick here. Mm. Sometimes people don't take you seriously for whatever reasons. And I had just previously moved to London. I was very new. I was living in a hostel as well. So money was tight. Trying to find housing was a massive struggle. And so just to find somewhere that is a base and you can just work from, that's what I really needed. And this course was flexible and it allows young people who are struggling and who aren't necessarily in a position where they can fund for big massive courses or big anything, and they can, you know, they can come to a safe place and everything's taken care of and you can learn from it.
Tell us how you joined Amy's Yard.
I joined Amy's Yard through my support worker because I went through quite a few things in my life and needed something to focus my mind and attention on. I didn't really want to make a depressing tune about, you know, my life and what I'd gone through and stuff like that. So I thought I'd be more positive and make a positive song, something that's fun, catchy, upbeat. Like, I love house music, I love that sort of genre of music. So to be able to do a song in Amy's actual studio was just a mind-changing, life-blowing opportunity, you know. Is this all really happening, or is it just pretend? They say the past is the past, and to learn from my mistakes. But what mistakes would they be? We're not thinking of the same. Well, at the time when I wrote the song, I was going through a really difficult time, and I didn't really feel like I could relate to anyone or speak to anyone. It was my first song that I ever wrote, so it was kind of a way of trying to put my experiences that I was feeling down to paper and then eventually into a song. So, in the next 5 years, I would like to be doing a lot more performances, maybe have recorded like at least an EP and be, just getting myself out there more and have established some sort of fan base. And without Amy's Yard, I definitely wouldn't have been able to achieve that because I have so much more confidence now. Look at me now, I'm a lot stronger. Look at me now, I'm stronger and grateful somehow.
Try to fool around. This is a warning.
It sounds like it could be about a person warning somebody about, you know, having a bad relationship with someone. But actually, it's about a relationship that I had with drugs. I was in rehab in 2014. It was just about my relationship with that thing. And now I'm in recovery and sort of watch out, you know. For a start, Amy's programs helped me with my confidence. So any goals I do set for myself seem much more like they're more able to achieve. So I'm at drama school. I'll be there for 3 years. And after that, you know, I want to be acting on TV, film, theatre, and I would love to have my album out and be doing my music, you know, yeah.
Why do you think Amy would believe this helps young people today?
Because that was Amy. Amy always wanted to help. She'd say, do it. And she'd encourage them. Because she can see through us what we're doing. And seeing that we are helping so many young people. And that's what it is. We're helping people, young people, to bring out what they can do in themselves.
This programme is brought to you by UCKG.
Welcome to your health centre, conveniently located right here in the heart of Finsbury Park. Open 7 days a week with 4 services daily, there's surely something for everyone. No matter what time of day, there will always be a spiritual advisor on hand, ready to speak to you. Call our 24-hour helpline, your place to open up any time of the day. No problem is too complex, so don't be dismayed. In fact, we have daily sessions that can tackle issues related to every area of your life from the inside out. If you're looking for uplifting advice, a listening ear, or maybe just a prayer to put your mind at ease, then feel free to come in. We also offer free childcare facilities during all of our meetings. We'll take care of them as if they were our very own. Or, for teens and youths, express your talents right here in our youth group, proudly one of the biggest youth groups in the UK. If you need our support, you will find it. From the training centre to support groups for single parents and the abused, free, confidential help is at hand. There's no appointment necessary, so you're welcome. And what's more, all the services we offer are all completely free. The advisors will give you practical, non-judgmental advice that will take the weight off your shoulders. Also, if you're looking for special gifts or an inspirational read, then why not visit our bookshops? We have a comprehensive range of thought-provoking literature at great prices. We work hard to provide for all of your needs from the inside out. Helping people is what drives us, so you're welcome.
This programme is brought to you by UCKG.
Welcome back. On today's show, we've been talking about bad girls to good women and life transformation. And I'm very, very excited because we've got a special guest, Carlotta Allen.
Hello.
Hello, welcome.
Hi.
Nice to see you all.
Welcome. Nice to see you too. It's wonderful to have you here in the studio. So Carlotta, you are the founder of the charity Stretch.
That's right.
You work with the Rehabilitation for Creative Arts, and I'm so excited about it. Now, tell us, what is it and why did you decide to get involved in it?
Okay, well, it was obviously driven by my own personal experience. I mean, I had a prison experience when I was young, and I managed to compartmentalise it for quite a long time afterwards, but I was volunteering in a prison and I was teaching art, and I wanted to do something that brought together these interests, like a passion in the welfare of prisoners and marginalised people, and also my love of the arts and culture. So I sort of invented this charity, which brought together the two loves of mine. So, yeah.
Wow. Nice.
Working so far.
Fabulous.
You said you went to prison earlier on.
Yeah.
You sound like you came from a nice family background. Why do you think you got involved in crime?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's once again, it has, you know, it's echoed in the stories that I've been hearing today. I think I was, it's just very much a position of where I was when I was 16. I was in Manchester, grew up in a nice middle-class suburb of Manchester.
I knew you said
And yeah, my brother was 3 years older, and I was a bit of a loner at school. Me and my best friend, we always looked up and hung out with my brother, and they were like quite cool grammar school kids, and they gave me my first spliff and sort of took us out to nightclubs, and we were always trying to sort of get in with that gang. So from that, we were always doing things that other people at our school weren't doing. We're often like hanging out with groups of people that were older than us. And then when I was 16, it was Acid House in Manchester, and we were going to the Hacienda, and we just got further and further into this sort of world. And it was almost decriminalised. It felt like, you know, it was such a sort of powerful thing that was going on in the town. I felt like everyone was just turning a blind eye to what we were doing, and we were just allowed to sort of get on with it and take drugs and party. But obviously it got a bit darker, and, you know...
How long did you actually spend in prison?
Not that long. I was treated very fairly in the end, and because it was in America, I was taking drugs over to America. I was a drugs mule, and if I'd been caught in England, I would have probably had to do a lot more mandatory. But because you can make a deal in America,
when you actually came out of prison, I mean, how hard was it to actually change your life around?
Like I said, I mean, I realised that I was one of the lucky ones. And I began to sort of get more interested in prisoners and how people end up in prison and crime. And even when I was in prison in LA, you know, there were girls there who had nothing. Nobody cared about them. And they just, like, no visits, nothing, no letters. And even from the UK, I had, you know, visits. I had loads of mail. I had lots of attention, phone lines, all sorts of stuff and help and support. And, you know, you see people there that have got nothing in their lives and nothing to go out to, and nobody cares if they're in prison or not. So I think you realise that it's that kind of network of support when you get out. That's what helps you come round. So, you know, I was able to come back to my life, my, you know, middle class. I'd managed to get through school. I'd managed to get to university, get my A-levels and that kind of stuff. So... I had that to fall back on as another side of my life. Like you said, you had like the two lives running side by side, and it's a bit like that, and you just sort of shut one down and just throw yourself into the other life. But I realised, and I began to realise more and more, that that's quite rare, you know, to be able to do that. And that's where the problems are, is that sort of lack of support, or lack of choices, really. Lack of choices, because some people just don't have that choice, so they just go back into the chaotic life of crime that they've had in the first place.
Obviously this is the kind of thing that obviously got you to thinking about what more could be done. So how did you go about founding the charity?
I was volunteering in a prison, like I said, and I just really wanted to sort of do more. And I wasn't talking about my experience then, because I didn't think they'd let me go into the prisons, basically, as an ex-offender. Wow. So it was all very hush-hush, and I did my first few projects. I was volunteering in a prison up in York, and I got some money from the Arts Council to take them to art galleries and things, and it all went well, and it kind of snowballed from there. But nobody knew about my past. I wasn't using it then, and that kind of came back then a few years later to bite me, because, you know, they felt that, you know, they couldn't trust me, and I should have been up front, which I should have been, you know. So the last 4 or 5 years have been very much about me being honest about who I am, and that's a really transformational process in itself, to sort of tell your story. And that's what I try and encourage other people to do now, just to sort of find creative ways to sort of tell their story.
So what are the main aims of the organization? Like, so what do you do? How does, you know, what
Well, we go into prisons mainly, but also work with ex-prisoners in the community, and also young people at risk and kids coming out of care and that kind of thing. All sorts of different creative projects to try and get people to sort of express themselves and a different way of sort of engaging with society, or engaging with education, or just growing in confidence and basic life skills. We've done all sorts of stuff, poetry, sculpture, do a lot of work with museums and galleries. But at the moment, we're doing like digital literacy and digital storytelling. So we're going into prisons with iPads and getting them to make little films about their life. And so you get some sort of technical... Look us up. So you get some technical skills, and but also that sort of, yeah, transformative sort of process of telling your story.
How do people take to it? Are they quite willing, or they're kind of resistant?
Yeah, well, it's not for everyone. Yeah. And there's some aspects of what I do, which is a bit, I don't know, yeah, you know, you go into a big men's prison and you're getting them all to sit in a circle and sort of share stuff. And it's a bit, yeah. So it's not for everyone. You get a few people storming out. So. But yeah, no, on the whole, it's brilliant. And, you know, the feedback. And also from the prison staff and people, you know, doing something a little bit different, yeah, and sort of engaging the guys in a different way, and the women, you know, work with women and men.
And you've seen the turnover of the ex-offenders changing their life and, you know, making a fresh start.
Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to track people that you've worked with in prison. But, you know, I take it as a success, even if you've change their life for a couple of weeks. You know, I mean, it's baby steps, isn't it? And even if you can just spark an interest in something or get people to, you know, maybe think, oh, well, you know, maybe I'll come back to this, maybe I'll try some more art, maybe I'll, you know, try some more writing, or, you know, express myself in a bit of a better way. You're just building that confidence. And
Have you ever had any resistance to what you're doing? Because, for example, I know that some people can kind of think, oh, you know, they've done the crime, they should be left in there.
Yeah, there's the Daily Mail Brigade who will always sort of throw away the key and lock them up and throw away the key kind of view. And you have to be very careful with press and things like that about, you know, say you're taking iPads into prisons. You know, we don't have iPads here, and that's not fair and all this. But I kind of think they should at least have the same facilities that a good high school has, or something like that, because, you know, a lot of people that have ended up in prison have dropped out of school early, you know, fallen through that net completely. So at least if you can offer them those kinds of facilities and creative media and art room and that kind of thing that they maybe missed out on when they were at school, you know, that's not special treatment, that's just, you know, something that they should have.
You know, I love a good story like this, you know, I really, really love it. I just think that it's so special when you see people that are able to take bad stuff that happens to them and then turn it round. And I hope you don't mind me asking, because I like to get a little bit personal, you know, obviously you went through this kind of bad girl situation, and even when I was listening to Diane and Sam, that time it kind of seemed glamorous. It kind of seemed like a good thing. Yeah. They were kind of enjoying that lifestyle. Was there an actual point that you got to that you decided that, you know what, I don't want to be this bad girl. This bad girl thing is just not working for me. I want to be this good girl. And did you have this image of who you wanted to be?
Yeah, kind of. I think a lot of what you're doing when you're chasing that kind of high, when you're sort of involved in easy money and that kind of lifestyle, is a kind of sensation seeking, isn't it? And it's when you kind of realise that you can get those pleasures from other places. So now I get really excited by work and when things go well, and my children, I often say my children save me, because, you know, it's so much easier being responsible for someone else than for myself, kind of thing. So you kind of get your highs, don't you, in a different way, kind of thing, and a more grown-up way, and it's a sort of maturation of, you know, just like, yeah.
Would you say that you're happy now because you are giving back rather than taking from
absolutely
society?
yeah and I get you know, really rewarded by what I do, and I'm proud, and my children are proud, and even though they know all about my past, and I think even my parents might be
well, at least you're not just sitting back and, you know, woe is me, and kind of
or just saying I'm the lucky one, thank goodness.
If you could have been the lucky one and then thought, oh, it's all right, okay, I'll do it again.
You're giving back.
Much more openness about, I mean, just look at, you know, the percentage in this room, for example, experiences in their past. And people sort of shove it under the carpet, and, you know, but it's quite a common story, really.
You know, what I really love about this as well is the fact of this internal issue that you have. So, people that often go into crime, like Sam was saying, is that they've got something inside them that hasn't really come out yet. And I think that's what's really nice about your charity, is that you are getting them to stop and think and do something different to try to get that internal thing, whatever it is that made them probably be bad in the first place, express themselves, to find out what happened, how did it happen?
Absolutely.
And seek another way.
It is a little bit kind of therapy, but yeah, you know, prison is a time for reflection, and it is often a time when people stop still in what is a very chaotic kind of life, and that is a time to sort of look back and maybe take stock and think, well, maybe, you know, this, and, you know, get some amazing, I'm always crying in workshops and when I listen to the stories and stuff, because, you know, people do come out with stuff and, you know, make those connections. You can see them making those connections as to why they might have ended up where they are.
That's wonderful. This is very special. Thank you so much for coming on our show.
Well, it's been a pleasure.
And all the best with all the work that you're doing.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, if you'd like to find out more about Carlotta's work, please go to our website, dkw.me. We're going to be coming back with our conclusion, so please stick with us.
This programme is brought to you by UCKG. This program is brought to you by UCKG.
Welcome back to the final part of the program, From Bad Girls to Good Women. And ladies, what a wonderful transformation story we've heard about the Carlotta, right?
Yes, really lovely.
Really beautiful.
Absolutely.
You know, it's so sad that it's quite rare that we find women who take their bad situations, decide to turn themselves around.
And to help others.
And then help others. Yeah. And I think that is so wonderful. But there are many people who just decide to remain bad girls.
Yes.
Allowing their past to keep repeating every single day, and it turns them into women that they don't even recognise. So that didn't happen with the two of you. Did it? Or has it?
No.
Has the transformation ever
happened? We wouldn't be here, would we, Di?
No.
So Carlos, she had her way of changing. What did you guys do? How did you guys change?
Well, I tell you something. It was very interesting with me because for some time, after a period of time, my heart was broken by
the
same partner, and I was really brokenhearted. And it came to a point where I really needed to change the lifestyle because I had a daughter, and it was either a couple... These things would have happened to me. I would have either ended up dead or in prison or addicted on drugs. So there was no positive line there that I would have ended up if I hadn't taken a decision to change. I mean, I was still involved with criminal activities, but I was actually trying to change my life. I wanted to do something different. I was absolutely traumatized with the whole thing. I couldn't go with this anymore. Something had to happen. And I accepted this invitation. It was actually by my sister. And she invited me to a church. And they started, you know, I was able to get one-to-ones. I was able to get counselling. I was able to get advice and guidance and on the areas of my life where I was failing. Because I'd now become a stage in my life where the money could not do anything. Mm. It was, you know, buying a shoes or an outfit for £500 or a pair of shoes couldn't do anything for you anymore.
You had enough of that already.
It was nothing. Mm. And inside of my heart was broken. Yeah. And I needed healing. Mm. I was able to receive advice, guidance, prayers. Mm. I became very God-fearing. Mm. I learned right from wrong, basically. And I was able to find the strength to change my life because it gave me the strength. And it actually opened my eyes to see that this lifestyle, it's wrong. Mm.
So who is Sam today?
Sam today, I'm no longer failing in any areas of my life, I can say.
Wow, that's powerful indeed.
Any areas of my life. You know, I have a successful marriage relationship where I had a broken relationship. Mm. I'm no longer involved with any criminal activities. Mm. My earning is honest. I earn my honest bread. You know, I have a successful life. I'm very happy. Mm. I have a career. I manage a training centre, yes. And to help other, I actually I'm qualified in counselling, so I help a lot of women, and men even at times, to help them to change their life, to let them see that, you know, there's, you know, Shireen, Lisa, Di will tell you, there's nothing set in stone.
Yeah, I love it.
There's nothing that cannot change. Mm. And it doesn't matter what, how you got into the position that you arrived in, there's a way out.
You don't need to stay there, do you?
There's a solution. Mm. You don't need to stay there.
Yeah. Lovely.
You know, and that's beautiful. What it's about.
Fab. Diane, how about you?
Once again, it's very similar to Sam. I mean, I'm not belittling it. It's a hard process, you know, to kind of, even though you wanna, you don't want that kind of lifestyle no more. You know, it's sometimes hard to draw yourself away because it's what you know. For me, I struggled at first. Yeah. You know, I was still half foot in and half foot out. You know, I kept going back, and you know, do I want that? Do I want this? You know, and then I realized that I was achieving certain things. Mm. I was, you know, I was overcoming certain obstacles.
And these obstacles that are you talking about internally?
Internally, yeah. You know, as I think that, you know, nobody doesn't want to live that kind of lifestyle. Mm. Personally, that's my personal opinion. No one don't want to, you know, they don't end up saying that that's what I want. What do you want to do when you grow up? Oh, I want to be a criminal. Mm. I don't think that that's, you know, that's their way or their ambition. So for me, it was seeing where I was going wrong, you know, the environment that I was in, basically. And I'm still in that environment, and I still see people going down that road. You know, when they look at me and I say to them, well, like, you know what, my lifestyle was this, 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 and this, and they're like, you. You know, and I'm like, yeah, me, you know. So I know that if I can change, it wasn't easy, so can you. So, you know, I've got myself in a position like Sam. I'm happy in my position where I am. You know, I've got a lot of things that, you know, I need to conquer.
Yes.
But I'm happily married, you know, I'm stable, you know, I can get up in the morning and earn an honest living, you know.
And you're a role model.
Yeah, and I don't need to fear, you know, sleeping in my bed or, you know, wondering what's, you know, if anyone's going to kick off my door or, you know, because that was the sort of lifestyle.
Yeah, indeed.
Who's going to kick off your door? You know, is your partner going to come home that night? Mm. You know, it was all those sort of things that was a day-to-day thing in your life. Yeah. I don't need to worry about those things no more.
Love it, ladies. Thank you. And, you know, we don't always have to be kind of a high-tech bad girls like these two were. Sometimes we're just a little bit of a bad girl like our Lisa here and I was. So, Lisa, tell us. And transformations you've made in life.
I mean, obviously I was not on the scale of the ladies here, but I think it can be easy to be drawn into that lifestyle. I mean, I used to steal, sometimes bunk off school. I did smoke cigarettes, I did smoke weed, like going clubbing at like 15 and things like that. So it's kind of like a mix of the two, I guess, it was in the background story, isn't it? Because, I mean, my mum was a single parent, probably from when I was like maybe like 9 or 10. Mm-hmm. She eventually had decided to move to London to get a better job because mm-hmm. we grew up in being a single parent, 3 kids,
yes.
by herself. Mm. The divorce had left her with a lot of debts and things like that. Mm. So when you're going to school and you want the same things that everyone else has got, but you can't have that. So, you know, sometimes you might steal it and things like that. And sometimes as well, being that age, we're not aware of all the issues and things that are going on.
Yes.
So for me, it's like, you know, I don't have the same things as my friends have. Mm. I can't go the same places. Mm. And then being in with that kind of crowd then, and then going from cigarettes and then smoking weed, and it seemed like a big jump. And then when my mum went to, she actually moved to London, and I stayed behind because I was in year 10 when she moved, so going to year 11, doing GCSEs. So got a lot more free time because I living with my grandma who works shifts as a social worker. So that meant like, the things I think like now I think crazy, like being 15 and going clubbing in Manchester and then missing the last bus home. So walking through Moss Side at like 1-2 o'clock in the morning, you know, just going about my business and think, when I think now, I'm like, you stupid girl, anything could have happened. But just because I wanted to be able to go out with my friends and all those kind of things and, you know, getting so drunk, ended up in hospital. It's just absolutely crazy. And it did get to the point where my mum was so frustrated because she was trying to do her best to give us a new life. And I'm here almost like doing the opposite, you know, and being pretty selfish and looking at the situation and only at myself and not about how it's affecting the family. But when you are that age, you don't see the bigger picture also. And I had lots of self-esteem issues and things like that, not really liking myself. And so it all kind of came to a head like that. But when I came to London and it was finding other people who seemed to be happy, you know, they had their head screwed on, they had a focus in life, and it was being around people like that that I got to say, actually, no, you don't have to take that path that many others and I can change. And so it's like things like that, so I can learn from those experiences, and what I have done is use that as well to help others who are similar. So I just think that, you know, regardless of your past, it doesn't have to be a black mark. It can actually be a new beginning, because through everything you learn something from it, and you can take that change and make a difference.
Wonderful. Wow, ladies, it's powerful. I mean, I could have just concluded on what you just said there, Lisa, but you've all demonstrated, as well as our guest Carlotta, that indeed our past doesn't need to impact our future for the worst. You can take it and turn it around. And actually at DKW, this program has been quite special to me because I do love to hear a good transformation story from time to time. But I find it interesting that, you know, there are ladies that will indeed live their lives as if their life is just one long day. And I think it's so funny how in nature that we always have to stop, go to sleep, then get up the next day. And it's almost like the laws of or the powers that be have told us that it's okay for you to leave your past behind and start a new day each day. Take the good parts of that day, move on to the next one, and anything that negative happened to you, you can use it for your good. You don't need to be stuck into it. And I find that quite interesting, almost as if we are built, no matter who we are, from our culture, our age, our race, our religion, whatever, we've got a reset button every single day we go to bed. So why not use that reset button? Why not take the bad things of the past and turn them into something that's going to strengthen you, make you a better person, and say, and learn from that experience, actually, to a point that you can help yourself and help others. This is what it is to really be different. Well, it's been a wonderful show. If you need help and you think, you know what, I would love to start my life again. I would like to be this good woman, this happy woman, but I'm just not sure how. On today's show, you found that there are different ways that these ladies have used in order to make that change. And if you'd like to find out more about these places, please email us at comments@dkw.me or help@dkw.me, and we'll be happy to help you. Until next time, take care.
This programme is brought to you by UCKG.